This is the Infatuation Podcast, where we get together with a few friends to talk about Asian things and Asian people that we love. I am Emily, and on today's episode, we are digging deeper into the freezer to pick out more of our favorite frozen Asian foods.
Welcome back, everyone, to episode 11, part 2. Last week, we were talking about Asian frozen foods, and we tried some corn dogs together, we tried some xiaolongbao together, and those are just kind of the appetizers, literally the appetizers, because today, we're getting into the meat, we're getting into the bigger items, we're going to have full stomachs by the end of today. But we are getting into more items, and back with us are three guests. We have Angus in Houston, Emily, and Melody here in San Francisco. Welcome back, guys.
Thanks for joining us.
So we are now going into the segment that we like to do at the beginning of all of our part twos, and it's called...
Asians being awesome.
All right. That's our theme song, written by Brian. Thanks, buddy. Quick correction, in this segment I say Paul Franklin, but what I meant to say was Paul Fleming. And we're going to do Asians Being Awesome, which this week is, you'll see the connection in a minute, all right? At first you may be like, what? And you know we usually do a Bay Area connection too. So this week's connection, or this week's Asian Being Awesome, is Cecilia Chang. Do you guys know Cecilia Chang?
Mm-mm.
She is a San Francisco legend. She just passed away, I think last year, at 100 years old.
Wow.
And she would say, some people would say that she was the one who revolutionized Chinese cuisine in America. She was born in Shanghai in the 1920s, and she had to flee the Japanese, and she walked over 1,000 miles from Shanghai to Chengdu. Wow. So during that time, she's running away from the communists, and then... Because she was part of a rich Shanghai family, and then back then that was not a good thing to be when the communists came in to Shanghai. So she was fleeing the communists and ended up in San Francisco in the 1950s. And then when she got here, she was really surprised at the Chinese food scene in San Francisco, which, see, a lot of people don't realize, but, you know, when Chinese came to America, it wasn't women, right? It was mostly men who came to America.
Mm-hmm.
And these weren't chefs, right? These were people looking for gold, came to work on the railroads or whatever. And so the first restaurants they had were simple food, country food, right? It wasn't stuff that, you know, the emperor was eating in China. This was country food that the people from southern China were bringing with them. And so in the 1950s, most Chinese food in America was, you know, chop suey, egg foo young, and just kind of real basic stuff, nothing fancy. And when Cecilia Chang got here, she was like, wait, because she was from Shanghai, the big city, right? She was like, wait, this is mm-hmm. this is not quintessential Chinese food. And so she brought over some chefs, and she brought over some knowledge, and she opened up this restaurant called The Mandarin, which was on Polk Street. And later, it moved to Ghirardelli Square, right across the street from Galileo High School.
Oh.
And this was a real famous place in the 60s. You know, John Lennon ate there, Frank Sinatra, Julia Child, Alice Waters from Chez Panisse. James Beard was a good friend of hers. So she was a real pioneer, okay? And so she was actually credited with kind of putting pot stickers on the map. So we talked a little bit about pot stickers. But she, back in 1961, guess how much a plate of 8 pot stickers cost at the Mandarin? 8 pot stickers for $1.
No way.
So, oh. And this was a fancy restaurant, too. This wasn't, you know, this wasn't a hole in the wall. This was a fancy restaurant. You can get 8 for $1. Mm. She was famous for her tea smoked duck, which, and kung pao chicken. She was kind of famous for kung pao chicken, which now is everywhere, right?
Mm-hmm.
And hot and sour soup was also kind of where, she, you know, so she kind of started that, which you find almost everywhere now. And, of course, the Peking duck. She brought that to San Francisco.
Wow.
Okay, but that's not, we're not done. We're not done yet. So she had that restaurant for many, many years. And I actually got to go there. My first couple years of teaching, it was still open, so I would go over there. But that's not mm-hmm. where her legacy ends. One of her chefs' name was Ming Sai Cheng. And he went on to buy a restaurant called, in the 1970s, he bought a little restaurant called Panda Inn. Does it sound a little familiar? So he was a chef that trained with her, and he bought this restaurant called Panda Inn, and his son and his wife ran it and turned it into Panda Express.
Wow.
Right?
Whoa.
So she's so her restaurant kind of spawned that, and then I'm not done yet. You think I'm done? So then Cecilia's son Philip, he ended up starting a Chinese restaurant with his friend Paul Franklin. Paul Franklin, P.F.
Oh my
and
god!
And Philip's last name, Philip's last name is Chang.
P.F.
And so they put a restaurant together called
P.F. Chang.
P.F. Chang's, yeah. And so that is that P.F. Chang. So her son started that restaurant, which is now ubiquitous and famous. I mean, okay. This is not great Chinese food at either of these places, but it's kind of neat that this one little restaurant in San Francisco spawned, you know, these huge empires now, you know, billion-dollar companies. And, you know, Philip Chang, so a lot of people question whether P.F. Chang's is authentic or not. Well, there is one Chinese guy there, and he actually spells his name C-H-I-A-N-G, kind of the Shanghai spelling of it. But he figured it'd be easier for people to say if they took out the I. So it's P.F. Chang. So it stands for Paul Franklin and Philip Chang. But it's crazy, right, that you know, these hundreds of chefs probably came out of her restaurant and all over America now. So hats off to you, Cecilia, and you will always be an Asian being awesome. So thank you for bringing some of the dishes that we now consider just classics, but she was kind of the one who started it in America. All right, you learned something there?
Was that fun? Yeah, that was awesome.
All right, we're going to do some more eating today, of course, and we're going to do some more recommending. But first, guess what we're going to do? We're going to take a frozen food quiz.
Oh.
Are you ready? Ooh. All right. This is not to embarrass you. Don't worry. Angus has got nervous. Angus, she's got a little test anxiety there. it'll be multiple choice. Don't worry, Angus. You're good at the multiple choice. Don't worry. I'll give you some options. All right. Let me pick a couple here. This isn't about frozen Asian food, but this is just about in general. All right. Here's one. Which container should you never put in the freezer? A, paper. B, glass. C, plastic. Which container should you not freeze food in the freezer? Paper, glass, or plastic?
I've done all three.
Yeah, but which one is, you can think about this. It's potentially dangerous.
I can think of paper with some potential leakage and stuff.
All right.
But that would be my choice. Cause...
All right. Emily, Melody, what do you think?
I'm guilty of putting all three in the freezer. But I kind of want to say plastic, but there's a lot of plastic in the wrapping of a lot of frozen food that we have.
Right.
I want to say paper.
All right. Well, you're all wrong.
Is it glass?
Well, this is a quiz on how stuff works. They say glass because if the glass is a little warm and you put it in the freezer, there's a potential that it could cool too fast and crack.
Oh.
So just for safety. I mean, you can do it. It's just be safer if you didn't do it. All right. About how long does food last in the freezer?
Forever.
About how long? So
lifetime.
Again, there's a range. There are, you know, forever's not a terrible answer, but here's the ones I'm going to give you here. 3 to 6 months, 6 to 9, or 9 to a year. I guess this is cooked food. Maybe let's qualify this as cooked food. So this isn't like raw ingredients. 3 to 6. 6 to 9 or 9 to 12 months?
6 to 9.
I would agree with 6 to 9.
I feel like 6 to 9 too.
Even though I probably have to longer than that. But...
All right. Yeah, no, I do too. Yeah. All right. Guess what, guys? You all got it right. You all got it right. So you have redeemed yourself. You have 50%. You have an F right now. But okay, let's give you a chance. Let's give you two more here. Two more. What is the most common nutrient that fruits and vegetables lose when you freeze them? Vitamin A, vitamin B, or vitamin C? Which nutrient do you lose typically when you freeze them in fruits and vegetables? Vitamin A, B, or C?
I'll go with like that.
Who wants to go first?
Yeah, go ahead.
So I feel like not vitamin C because people use frozen fruits for smoothies. So I want to say A or B, but I don't know.
My same logic. And then for vitamin A, we have frozen carrots too. So that's they come to vitamin B. It's just there's so many varieties of B1, B12, etc.
All right. Am I hearing an answer here? Are we stalling? Can we get an answer here? What are we saying? You're saying A?
B.
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 B. Melody, final answer?
B.
You going to ride with the team?
Yes, ride with the team.
All right. Guess what? You're all wrong again. It's vitamin C. I think it's the water solubleness. They said you can lose about 30%. So, I know we have superfoods, right? We have asahi and blueberries and all those things, and we freeze them. But it would be better if you ate them fresh. You get 70% of your vitamin C. It's still good. But all right, so we got to redeem our. We got one last one. Should I try to find an easy one here? All right, what is the optimal temperature for your freezer? And this is in Fahrenheit, 10 degrees, 5 degrees, or 0 degrees?
Zero.
Zero.
Wow, really quick, Mel. Really quick, Emily.
Zero.
Angus going zero?
Well, I think it's
now, this
zero.
Is Fahrenheit.
Because I was going to say, if I open my fridge now, the thermometer would read 0 Fahrenheit for the freezer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But at least it's not.
Melody Wong.
Angus is an engineer, so you might want to go with Angus.
Probably zero, but I never pay attention to those things.
Well, you have redeemed yourself. It is 0 degrees.
Yeah.
Solid 50%.
I looked at my refrigerator recently, and it's that recommended temp for freezer. Yeah. Zero.
Makes sense, right? Makes sense. Even though freezing is 32, you want to be below 0 Celsius. So you want to be at below freezing, right?
Yep.
You don't want to be right at freezing. So good job. Good job, everyone. I'll give you a prize. Your prize is some more frozen food. How about that?
Woo-hoo. Ooh. And if you curve this quiz, we all get A.
I don't know. We have to talk about it. You need to do some extra credit maybe later. I'll have an extra credit assignment for you. All right, well, let's go ahead and move on to our next challenge. Oh, wait, am I recording? Yeah, I'm recording, right? Okay. I panicked for a second there. I was like, wait, did I pause it? No, I just let it run the whole time. Good. Okay,
yep.
So we're moving on to some more frozen food suggestions, and I think what we're going to do is run back to our kitchens and make two more dishes, and then we'll talk about some food dishes. So everyone out there, you can do the same. If you're listening, you can go to your kitchen and make some food. But we're going to, I'll tell you a couple things we're going to be microwaving right now. We're going to microwave Suhki's, I don't know if I'm saying that right, but S-U-K-H-I, Suhki's Irresistible Indian Cuisine. We're going to try some chicken tikka masala, and it comes with naan.
Nice.
It's like a full meal. It's a full meal. And we're also, in honor of Cecilia Chang, we're going to try P.F. Chang's frozen food, dan dan mian. So we're going to try some dan dan noodles. What is that literally? What does dan dan mean?
Does dan dan mean bouncy?
Is that what it means?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure, though.
The noodles used to be made with someone that actually sit on the bamboo and kind of bouncing the dough so they make it chewy.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think you're right. It's that guy with the bamboo pole pounding the noodles.
Was that the part about the person that would carry the kind of the bamboo on the shoulder and carry the noodles around and so? I don't know which one is which there.
All right, let's Google this. What does dun dun mean?
Noodles carried on a pole.
That's the second one that I was talking about.
But it's bouncing. That the idea is that when you carry that pole, yeah, that
like dun dun.
That makes sense. All right, so we'll give that one a try, and then we're going to come back, and we'll talk about some other ones that we're not actually going to try. But hang out, everyone, for a minute, and we'll be right back. So we are now into our main courses. These are a little more substantial. These have a little meat in them. Well, so do the dumplings. But we are trying some bigger dishes today. And these are a little more expensive. So I think these range $5-6, somewhere around there. So they're not super cheap. You know, I think you're paying for the convenience. You're paying for the packaging and the shipping and all that. But you know, in a pinch, when you need a dinner, when you need a meal, when you want to try some Asian comfort food or have something that brings you comfort, these frozen foods, these are the way to go, I think. Oh, good. Emily is doing our social media for us. Thank you. Taking some pictures of our food, which I keep forgetting to do. But my first recommendation for us here is P.F. Chang's Dun Dun Mian, which we talked about a second ago, being the bouncy noodles. And I just tried these not too long ago for the first time, and I was pretty impressed. I'm curious what you guys think. But let's go ahead and try it. We're going to try it. It has, is that ground pork? I didn't read the package. It's ground beef or ground pork. Yeah. It's got some mushrooms. It's got a little kick to it. It's not spicy, but it's got a little kick to it. And
have you guys had dun dun noodles before in restaurants?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that would be hoping, good. I want to see. Yeah, I want to see what you guys think. All right, give it a try.
Hoping for a little bit of spice.
A little spice. More of a northern dish, right? A little more northern Chinese. Oh, Angus says only $4 in Texas.
Yeah.
I'm try a mushroom. What do you think? Should I edit out a slurping or should I leave the slurping in?
Leave it.
The audience needs to hear it. Not bad, right?
It's got some kick.
Yeah, a little bit of spice. I feel like the ones in Chinese restaurants, is it a little thicker?
Mm-hmm.
The noodles. But this is pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
For like a quick fix if you're craving it.
The noodles are pretty good.
Yeah, they're not mushy.
I like the mushroom. They're pretty good.
The flavor is pretty rich. And the sauce is, you know, pretty viscous, I would say. Mm-hmm.
And only 510 calories. I did check this time. I don't know whether it's the whole serving or that's just, you know, sometimes they will put the numbers, but it's like one-fifth of the serving or...
Again, it's so flavorful. I feel like you could try, you can mix this with maybe even another package of noodles. You know, there's enough flavor where you could definitely have it with some veggies.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The pork is good. Mm-hmm. A bit chewy. I like the green onions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Got some chili flakes.
Maybe some sort of bok choy or Chinese broccoli, two or three stalks of that. That would go for a while.
Mm-hmm. You can definitely elevate this.
Mm-hmm.
You know what would be good? I was actually thinking of getting like some big lettuce leaves and doing like you could wrap them in the lettuce leaves and roll it up.
Oh.
Right? Thinking outside the box.
Melody, would you add an egg to this if you were to make this? Do you think an egg would go well?
I feel like an egg goes well with anything. I could. But I feel like it is missing a little bit of veggies. Like, I would like maybe even the cucumbers on the sides. Like, I kind of want something to offset the strong flavors.
Yeah. Some cabbage.
But it's pretty good.
More mushrooms.
More mushrooms.
Yeah.
I'm impressed.
It's not bad. Good old P.F. Chang's. I've never been to a P.F. Chang's. Have you ever been to a P.F. Chang's?
I've been once in New York.
I've been once,
oh, really?
Too. Yeah. It was like we're in place of one of the lounges, and I have a priority pass, so you got free credit to eat at P.F. Chang's. Mm.
I've been on a date at P.F. Chang's. So.
You took a date to P.F. Chang's?
My dating experience, it's quite diverse. I can't really take someone.
It's classy.
To a mom and pop place in some cases.
Well, I think that's one of the attractions, right? Is that it's going to be clean, it's going to be quiet, it's not going to be like a, you know, like we all love our hole in the walls, but, you know, sometimes their health scores are a little low, or their cleanliness is questionable, or their noise level, and the ambiance isn't there. So P.F. Chang's, you know, figured out, hey, you know, Americans get intimidated by menus, and they get, you know, the wait staff at some of these hole in the walls may not be the friendliest or the easiest to work with. So P.F. Chang says, you know what, we're going to make a restaurant, and yes, it's not totally authentic, but it's going to be comfortable. It's going to be accessible to anyone in America, right? And it's going to taste good. And you're going to, you know, they have the set menus. If you don't even want to think about it, you just go with a set menu and just let the chef put it together for you. So,
and it's familiar to people that don't have a lot of exposure to Asian culture.
Exactly.
You know, you have the sweet and sour chicken. Mm-hmm. So there's a good transition going from there before you go into the deep dive into the dumplings and the craziness. Well, I wouldn't say craziness.
But if you're not used to it, a Chinese restaurant can be crazy.
Yep.
All right.
How would you guys rate that?
Ooh. Out of 10?
Sure, yeah.
Maybe a 7 or 8, I think.
Yeah.
If it's frozen food, I would give it a 7 or 8.
Yeah, I think for frozen, I would probably say it's like a 7 because it knocks out your craving.
A 7.
And the noodle texture is pretty good. Good amount of like meat bits.
Generous on the meat, actually.
Yeah, it really is. And it gets your mouth tingling a little bit, right? I feel it. I feel the tingle.
The lips a little bit.
the Sichuan peppercorn?
Yeah.
Is that what it is?
So my daughter can handle it, so it's not too spicy. But yeah, the chewiness, what I liked about it was the chewiness of the noodle. I like to bite into a noodle and not a mushy thing. And But again, yeah, you're paying for the convenience. You know, you're going to have it at work and it's ready for you in 5 minutes. You're going to have it when you get home from work. And it's comfort food, right? It comforts you. I love a bowl of noodles. Sit in front of the TV, watch a K-drama. I think a beer would go well with this. I like beer with spicy food. You know, just sit there, watch your Asian drama, and maybe have a beer and some noodles. Call it a night. All right. Let's work our way through a couple of these. Oh, Melody, I love your pick here. Why don't you go over your pick?
Yeah, so I like to get the orange chicken from Trader Joe's. It's funny how we talked about Panda Express and P.F. Chang's today. this was something that I kept buying over and over again when I was in college because it comes with a bag with little chicken bits that are already fried. Just toss it in a pan with some oil. And like sometimes I would just eat that, top it with some like white pepper. And then like that's kind of like my alternative to popcorn chicken when I wanted it in college. And then they also have this sauce packet. I think it comes with two sauce packets. It's a little sweet, a little bit sour, a little bit tangy. There's some vinegar flavor in it. I think it's really good. I like Panda Express a little bit more than this, but I think this comes to a close second when you don't have access to that.
What I love about it is a couple things. One, like you said, if you're living by yourself in college, you don't need you know, huge order, right? So maybe you just want a couple nuggets at a time. You don't have to heat the whole bag. You know, you can heat a little bit. And I also like the fact that the sauce is on the side. So the chicken is super crispy because you, and I'll do it in the convection oven, or, you know, you could do it in an air fryer, but you, the pan is great, right? But you can add as little sauce as you want, no sauce, a lot of sauce. They give you way more than you would ever need, I think. So I love that about it. The flexibility on a weeknight. If, you know, it's just me and one of my daughters, we'll do half a bag. If it's all four of us, we'll do the whole bag, you know, and I love it over rice. And again, it's not official, authentic Chinese food, but it hits a spot, man. You know, the orange chicken just, and everyone loves it. Just as Panda Express's, you know, thing, right? Their whatever they call it, sesame chicken or orange chicken, that kind of stuff is always number one item at these buffets or these restaurants. You guys like this dish too? Have you had it?
I haven't. I feel like I find myself adding to my grocery list throughout this podcast. Now I have like the crab rangoon, and you know, now I have orange chicken and green onion pancakes. So I haven't. I'm excited to try. It sounds amazing.
Yeah. Same here.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So yeah, definitely give it a try. You can go ranch dressing. Like my daughter likes the nuggets with ranch. You know, they're basically chicken nuggets.
Yeah,
but they're real chicken.
They're like better than chicken nuggets, though. I feel like real pieces of chicken nuggets with good coating, not too much flour, too.
Yeah.
So is it really popcorn chicken then?
And it's more like it's more like a chunk of chicken that it's like breast meat, and it's not processed like a nugget.
Okay.
So it's a piece of breast meat cut into a chunk, breaded and fried, and then you can bake it or fry it again.
I didn't realize the sauce was separate from the bag, so I just kind of never really picked it up because I thought it would be, you know, soggy. Mm-hmm. But it sounds like it's going to be crispy, so I'm interested.
Do it. All right, now Angus is taking us to another level here. He's going to recommend. Yeah, go ahead and do your rec here, Angus.
No, so, I mean, when we talk about frozen food for the entree, it's what you have in the fridge. And sometimes I just stock a lot of seafood. I'm a weekday pescatarian. I mean, I would have fish fillets and stuff. But if you go to some of the big Asian grocery stores, they would have those surf clams. Those are the kind of the clams that you have. And you have that in Japanese restaurants for sushi and stuff. So a lot of times I have a box in my fridge. That's the main stock. If I want something meaty, protein, that easy to fix up, I just take it out from the freezer, rinse it with water, kind of defrost it in a little bit, add a little bit of fish sauce, a little bit of sesame seeds oil. And that's kind of a good chunk of quick fix protein that you can get for your entree.
Wow.
Yeah, it's just a little bit more work, right? It's not like you're cooking for hours.
No. You can fix it up within 5 minutes.
Yeah, I think it's the only time I've ever had surf clams was in those Asian banquet dinners, right? Like where they come in a shell with like vermicelli noodles and garlic. But
yeah,
like I really like them, but I've never had them like in a different way. So I'm kind of intrigued by this.
My mom made it a lot too. So
that sounds easy. And a lot of times people are intimidated by cooking seafood because, you know, it seems a little harder. But yeah, shrimp and clams are super easy to cook. Fish can be a little hard. So I'm always a little intimidated by cooking fish, but shrimp or clams sounds all right.
Yeah.
Great. Thanks, Angus. And then you have another fish recommendation out here.
So like what I said, I'm a pescatarian. So most of my entrees are more on the seafood side. You can pick up fried rice you can obviously go to the store or go to a restaurant and order takeouts, and I do too. But sometimes, you know, in the bind when you work late at night, you just want to pick up something. And these are little packets that you can find in Ranch 99 or some other Asian store. They're from Taiwan. I think the brand is Yimei, or I may have pronounced it wrong. But yeah, they have the vegetarian fried rice. They have the salmon fried rice. That's the one that I go with and microwave it. And here you go. Just very simple when you have that carb craving.
And it's got everything. You don't add anything to it?
Nope, you don't add anything. It's just basically a good single portion. Yeah.
Salmon fried rice.
Mm-hmm.
Yimei is a, you said Taiwanese or Chinese?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So And the vegetarian is true vegetarian, so that's another thing that I look for. And then, you know, I can't get away without mentioning Trader Joe's. They also have a very good fish korma too. So, and in fact, the entree is just very good portion. I mean, decent portions. Some of them have rice already in it. And obviously for this one, the fish korma also have rice in it. And then just microwave it up and good to go. I mean, I don't eat a lot of frozen food, but sometimes when I'm in a bind, I have a few in the fridge that I can go with in case anything happens.
Yeah. We're not advocating you eat this three times a day, right? These are things that have, you know, they're convenient, but, you know, this is not replacing good home-cooked food. But, you know, when you need fish korma, if you were going to make that at home, that would be some effort, right?
That would be some effort.
Definitely, you know, the Indian spices or, you know, the South Asian spices that you need to make these dishes is pretty extensive. and again, I said I'm pretty intimidated by cooking fish.
Yeah. So, and then curry is a comfort food. I mean, I enjoy every single, I mean, different curry. I mean, I don't know whether you all know about cocoa curry from Japan. It comes in a little package, but they're like a convenience store, kind of a fast food chain. And I would bring some back to the States, but I mean, we're talking about frozen food. They're not frozen, but curry, it's a good frozen or fridge food that it actually tastes better the day after or the week after.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the thing is you got to cook it for a long time to get the flavors soaking in. And sometimes you don't have the time for that or the knowledge. And so these items might be a way to satisfy your curry cravings. What was behind your decision to go pescatarian during the weekdays? Is it for health or for the environment?
A little bit of both. It just carbon footprint was one of them, and kind of more eating healthier protein. I mean, I eat pork, chicken, and beef and all the rest during the weekends, but during the week, I try to eat a little bit cleaner, and protein for fish and seafood is generally have kind of the cleaner type of protein. I mean, I eat a lot of soybeans, you know, tofu and stuff too. But.
Yeah, no, that's great.
Yeah.
It's definitely better for the environment. You know, like beef is so tough on the environment in terms of raising cows. I'm saying that I love hamburgers, I love beef, but if we can go a little bit less per person, and it's going to take, you know, 7 billion of us to do this, right? We can't just do it one person. Well, one person can't make a difference by themselves, but if everyone does a little, it helps a little bit. So yeah, cool. All right, Emily, you got your recommendation down here?
I do. And today I'm going to talk about the Kim Sun beef and beef tendon meatballs.
Ooh, these are legit.
It's got to be this brand, okay? I feel like I'm so particular with, like, you gotta air fry your, you know, your appetizers. And I think I've tried so many different types of beef balls, and this is the best one. Mm. And this is pretty versatile, and I don't know if you would, you know, say this is a full-on entree, but it's definitely a complement to a lot of meals. I can eat this on its own with a bit of, you know, sriracha or hoisin sauce. It's actually one of the first things that my mom taught me how to cook. And by cook, I mean boil. So, you know, in middle school, if she were to leave me at home, I would just boil that and have it with sriracha and hoisin. This is the beef ball that, you know, we eat a lot of when we're at pho. Right? This goes in our pho. And I love it. Sometimes I'll add it to my noodles, and that'll be a beef ball noodle soup. But lately I've been making it with curry.
Mm.
Yeah. I went to visit my parents a couple weekends ago, and my mom, you know, made this with just her normal chicken curry recipe, but instead of chicken, she used beef balls, and it was so good. And I made it last weekend, and I used the beef balls, and I also used some frozen fish cakes.
Mm-hmm.
And it was easy. It was amazing. And I really like this brand of beef balls because you can really, you know, taste the tendon, and that adds a lot of texture to it. Mm-hmm. I've definitely bought beef balls where it's, you know, all beef, and the texture of the beef ball is pretty, it's kind of dull. There isn't a lot of chew. So this one is good because it has some chew. And it reminds me a lot of the beef balls from pho.
What brand of beef ball do you recommend?
The Kim Sun. It's called Gum San.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, Kim Sun. And, you know, frozen aisle, grocery store, where all the meatballs are, the fish balls, meatballs.
Does it have to be an Asian market? You think it has to be, or do you think they would have it at a non-Asian market? Or?
I don't think so. I don't think so. No Safeways.
Yeah. Mm-mm. So you got to go to your ranch. You got to go to your Asian market.
Yeah. I actually can't even find this one at H Mart.
Mm.
I haven't seen this brand before, but I like get beef and beef tendon meatballs all the time.
I've tried a couple. This one's my favorite. I get it from Chinatown.
I've never paid attention to the brand. I guess I'm not a connoisseur like you,
Emily. You know,
I just grab whatever's there. But next time I go, I'm going to look for this brand for sure.
Yeah. I don't know. Have you guys noticed, you know, the different beef balls that are used in pho? I don't know if this is something that you guys notice.
I do. Really. There's actually like a pho restaurant, Kevin's Noodle House. It's one of my favorites in the city. Sometimes their beef balls have like little black peppers in it, and I really like it when they have that versus like sometimes I can tell when they have like different meatballs and it doesn't have the black peppers, because I always like look forward to the ones with the black peppers and the ones with the beef tendon.
Yeah.
I'm the same way. I like a little bit of texture instead of just the paste, you know. That's just But you all got to come to Houston. I mean, Texas is famous for barbecue, but Houston is also, we have quite a big Vietnamese population. And I think Curtis talked about that show in the other podcast about the guy that do the three range price range and
worth it.
Worth it. I just never knew the name, but they did a far episode. I don't know whether you all remember. The lowest price range one is in Houston. And then they went all the way up to the lobster pho, whatever, in Vegas, I think. That was the episode. My memory kind of not as good as before, but we have some pretty good pho.
All right.
I don't know about in the Bay Area, but in Houston, you would also ask for a small cup of the bone marrows.
Oh.
So you can get your pho, and then for another $3-4, you get a cup of the bone marrows. And then once you mix into it, that's another level of that too.
Oh, man.
Wow.
All right.
I would love
that. Pro tips.
Next episode, we'll be in Houston.
I wish. Our budget is a little small. Our budget is a little small for that. Unless we all get in the car together and we drive over there. All right, so the last thing we're going to try together is, now, you know, I have to say, you know, Trader Joe's has quite a variety, but a lot of the Safeway stuff or a lot of the frozen food that I saw tends to be East Asian, you know, Japanese, Chinese, or Korean. So I wanted to try to find some Southern Asian or South Asian food, and Trader Joe's has the Korma curry. But this is a brand that I found at Safeway, so I wanted to try it because it says Suhki Singh is an Indian woman who this brand is from. So I picked it up, and we're going to try it. It is chicken tikka masala, and it's a full meal. It comes with rice and a naan. So follow the directions. I think you got to do the naan for like 15 seconds separately. But so we'll go cook this up, and we'll gather back for a little tikka masala. To be honest, I'm getting pretty full. But for the pod, we will power through, and we'll do this, and we'll have some leftovers for our family to share if you're living with someone. So I'll meet you guys back here in about 5 minutes, and see you then. थोड़ा सब से जुदा थोड़ा खुद से हुआ जो मैं कह ना सका नजरों में है लिखा जरा पढ़ के बता तू
आँखों में तेरी मेरी राहों में एक पल भी ना हो फासला अब देखूं ना आए जो अब कोई सुबह तेरे बिना और चाहूं ना हो सच कोई ख्वाब मेरा तेरे
All right, we are back with our last entree, and we're struggling. I'm struggling a little, to be honest. This is a marathon, but for the podcast, we will force ourselves, and then afterwards, I think we're going to hit the treadmill or the sofa. I don't know. it's a good Saturday afternoon for us here, but we're going to try this Suhki's Irresistible Indian Cuisine Tikka Masala. It comes with, I'm looking at a little portion of rice, little portion of chicken. Pretty good portion of chicken.
Yeah.
It's like breast meat.
Mm-hmm.
And a big, pretty good sized piece of naan.
Mm-hmm.
So are you guys using your fingers? How are you going? Are you going fork? You going to roll it up?
Yeah,
you
got to
go Indian style?
Fingers.
Yeah, you got to go fingers. I got to keep one hand clean so I can operate my mouse. Let's dig in.
Mmm. The naan is good.
The naan is good.
Ooh.
And you need it for this sauce. You need this extra bread for the sauce, too.
Yeah.
Oh, the chicken is good. Not too spicy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
not
but
very
a little.
Spicy. Mm-hmm. I like the curry flavor.
Yeah, it's got a little richness to it. Like, it's not watery. It's a good... I don't know what oil they use, but it's not buttery, but it's got a little fat in it somehow.
It's mm-hmm. very flavorful. Mm.
Yeah, I think it's not as buttery as I expected it to be. But the naan kind of has a little butter, I think.
Yeah.
Now, how do your naans taste? What do you think about the naan and the texture?
It's not amazing.
Yeah.
But it's solid. It's mm-hmm. a solid naan.
I'm very impressed by the naan. And I know Curtis and Angus, you guys microwaved it, right?
Mm-hmm.
And is it good?
It's about rich, I would say.
Mm-hmm. It's a little crispy.
You did the air fryer, so it's crispier. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I did the air fryer, yeah. too.
That's why I figure it's probably the air fryer.
That might be the way to go.
Mm-hmm. I can eat this whole thing.
Yeah, I mean, I was pretty full, but I think I might be able to finish this.
Yeah, I think it kind of opens my appetite, too. Like the curry flavor.
I guess that's a compliment, right? All right, Suhki.
How about the rice?
Like long grain rice, the characteristics are pretty solid.
And I think the package mm-hmm. says everything's halal.
Mm.
And the chicken is no antibiotics. Sorry, my mouth is full.
I kind of wish it was a little less dry. I feel like the rice could be had a little bit more water.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
Maybe it depends on how much you vent it, too. Like, they say mm-hmm. just peel back, you know, put a couple holes in it, and then mm-hmm. do 2 minutes. And then they say peel it back, stir it, and put it back on. But then once I peeled it back, my film was gone. Basically, it was all rolled up, so I had to just cover it. So I might have, maybe if you covered it again better, it would be not as dry, mm-hmm. maybe. And it's not super cheap. I think this was five something or what? How much did you pay, Angus? Do you remember? $5.99 or $4.99?
I got it at Whole Foods, so I want to say it's close to $7.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh.
But I couldn't find it at a regular store, though.
Oh.
It's not a very big portion, though. Mm-hmm.
I think if you ate all the bread and the rice, you might fill up, though.
Yeah. My eyes are always bigger than my stomach.
But yeah, it's not a huge portion for $7. It's a little, but I think she was going for quality ingredients.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
No preservatives, no antibiotics, no added hormone, she says, halal. So maybe that adds to the cost a little. Mm-hmm. I'd be curious, any of my South Asian listeners out there, if you ever tried Suhki's food, let me know. I was thinking about asking Mr. Punjabi to try it see what his opinion is of it, but I didn't get around to it. But I think it tastes good. I was pretty impressed.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Trader Joe's has a tikka masala too. Have you?
I've tried that one.
I like that one too. But I think that the portion is even smaller than this, from what I remember. And I feel like the chicken in the one at Trader Joe's wasn't as moist as the one in this one. It's not. This one isn't very dry.
Yeah. And consider how big some of the chicken pieces are. That's the first thing that I would worry. But they're pretty moist. So.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
In terms of frozen food, I think I would, rate, although it's, very different cuisine, but I would rate this one higher than the dandan noodles in terms of quality and taste and flavor. This is definitely a solid 8.5 for me. I think it's
8.5.
I'm impressed. Mm. Yeah.
Good.
What I could. But I always say, can't go wrong with curry-ish type dish for frozen food, though.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it's 8.5. It's pretty solid. I would get this again.
Mm-hmm.
Probably over the Trader Joe's one.
Curry's not something that I could eat every day.
Yeah.
But I do crave it, once in a while. And so it'd be nice to have it in the freezer because, like we said, making a nice, and not that this is curry, this is tikka masala, but like the Indian spices, I don't crave every day, but I do crave it once in a while. And I don't think I can make a good tikka masala personally. I could probably try, but again, you got to get all the spices to do it. And, a good spice mix could have 9 to 12 spices in it, if you really want to do it right. So, and this is slow cooked, this would be a whole afternoon, I think, if you wanted to make this. So this is kind of a nice alternative to satisfy your South Asian food craving. Or, give Trader Joe's a try. Angus recommended the fish korma. But I think we have some options here. We got some weeknight options if you want to satisfy some kind of hankering, some kind of craving you might have to get your taste buds going. We have the dandan mian, we have the tikka masala, we have Angus's surf clams, or salmon fried rice, which actually now that sounds really good. Or the beef balls, or the Trader Joe's orange chicken. We have so many options here. I think it's, I don't want to say unlimited, but you could spend weeks and weeks trying every frozen food, right? There are so many different ones. And so hopefully you have some near you at whatever market you are at. I found this, the Suhki's I found at Safeway. Angus said he went to Whole Foods. The P.F. Chang's, where did you get your P.F. Chang's from, Angus?
It's a grocery store called H-E-B. It's one of the big chain in Texas.
Yeah. So,
but they didn't have the Suhki ones.
So yeah, I think that most of the big stores will have the P.F. Chang's. I think Panda makes food too, right? Panda makes frozen food. All right, so we did not. I'm not totally regretting it, but I'm kind of regretting that we didn't go get desserts. So we're going to talk about desserts. We have a couple frozen desserts that to recommend. Of course, a lot of Asian households, fruit would be your dessert, right? Mm-hmm. You have some fruit, or we're not, a lot of Asian families are not into heavy sweets, but there are some interesting things coming out of the frozen food aisle in terms of desserts. So let's see, let's go. Emily, you want to recommend your dessert to us?
Sure. On the topic of fruit, my favorite dessert, or frozen fruit is durian. I know durian is so polarizing. You either love it or you hate it. I love it. How do we feel? Let's assess the room first. How do we feel about durian?
I'm a no.
I feel like most people are very polarizing. It's a hard no or I love it. But I happen to be right in the middle.
I can have it. I like it sometimes, but I don't need it.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm a hard no.
Also a hard no.
Okay.
But maybe it's just because I didn't grow up with it. I think you have to, as a kid, you have to have memories of it. Mm-hmm. Did you grow up with it, Emily?
Oh, yeah. But, you know, my dad, you know, he doesn't like durian either. So, okay. Not a lot of people in my life do. And that's okay. But I love durian. It's the texture. I think all the aspects about durian people don't love, I love. Like the smell, I love the smell. The sliminess, whoa, I love. The butteriness, I love. And you know, if you go to the grocery store and get a fresh durian, one, it's like $5 a pound, right? Yeah. So it's really expensive. Sometimes it can even go for like $9.99 a pound. It looks like a weapon. Like, there's no way I'm opening that thing. Yeah, you know, there's just no way I can physically open it. My mom would be able to, but now that we don't live together, I can't have my mom open a durian for me. So the next best thing is frozen durian. And I get the one from H Mart. And, you know, if you take it out of the freezer, let it thaw for, you know, 10, 15 minutes, it's kind of like durian ice cream. It's a big, big durian fan. So that would be my, you know, my favorite dessert, frozen, from the frozen food aisle.
We'll take your word for it.
And in the freezer too. Like, even when we get it fresh, like my family puts it in the freezer so that we can eat it later as if it's ice cream.
And it melts up kind of like a custard, kind of smooth.
Well, we just like put the whole piece in the freezer, and then like we would hold it and kind of like bite it or suck on it.
Oh, wow. Okay. All right. And how about you, Melody? Do you have a dessert for us? Dessert recommendation?
Yeah, I like getting the boba ice cream. Tons of new flavors now. They have like a matcha one. They have taro ones with like taro bits, or they even have this like pudding one. It's like pudding flavor with little like bits of pudding. And then there's like boba chunks in there. And that satisfies like my boba craving.
Mm. Ooh.
Does it have tea? Is it made with tea and caffeine, or is it caffeine free?
Oh, good question. I feel like matcha might have a little bit of caffeine, but I feel like most of them, the boba popsicle is like a brown sugar one. It's kind of milky. I think no caffeine.
I'm asking because of my kids. I don't want them to be eating one at 8 o'clock at night. Yeah, I've never tried those. I see them, you know, I see them and people post on Instagram with them a lot. So maybe I'll have to give it a try.
You haven't tried the popsicles?
I haven't.
Oh, yeah. Oh, Angus, have you?
Yeah. They even sell at a Costco now. So yeah.
Curtis, I am surprised.
Are you boba shaming me right now?
Yeah, I'm, you know, disappointed, all right. Truly.
All right. I will step up my game. I got to go try some. No, it actually has the boba. It has a chewy boba inside. So as you're eating it.
Mm-hmm. It's more of a mochi, though. What do you guys think? Do you think it's more of a mochi consistency or like a boba?
I think it depends on the popsicle, but it's a little bit more like a mochi, but it. Kind of, yeah, it's not exactly a boba.
Yeah, because it's kind of half frozen anyway, so it's not exactly like a boba. But you get that chewiness also, so yeah.
Yeah. Now, they're a little pricey, right? They're not super cheap. What's a box go for, $5 or?
Yeah.
Maybe like $6.99 or like $4.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Come to Texas.
Everything's cheaper.
Just eat boba popsicle.
All right, Angus. I think you were going back to Trader Joe's with your pick.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I've lived in places where there are not Asian stores in the U.S. Yeah. And when they have Trader Joe's, that's one of the reach back that I can go to. But I think we were talking about boba, but mochi is my thing. So Trader Joe's and well, even a lot of the mainstream supermarket now have mochis, but I also love ube. So any kind of ice cream, mochis, I mean, Trader Joe's, whenever they have that for that particular time frame for the past couple of years. That's what they do. But I, one thing that I don't know whether you all know, but we just passed the Mid-Autumn Festival too.
Mm-hmm.
So there was that frozen mooncake, what they call snowy mooncake, whatever, kind of the, yep, the mochi type skin and the wrap, mm-hmm, inside with the ice cream, whether it's mango. And I think there was one for durian too.
But, ooh.
Yeah, that's usually my goal for around this time of the year too. But so I'm a very mochi person.
Hmm. You know, I wonder who's buying this food for Trader Joe's or who's finding this food, because they're doing it. Whoever it is doing a good job.
Mm-hmm.
Like they're sourcing it at a good, you know, they're finding it or making it, or I don't know where they're coming up with this stuff. But their Asian frozen foods they're solid. Like a lot of them, I haven't had a bad one yet. The Korean pancakes are good.
Mm-hmm.
They have the teriyaki beef. They have, what else do we have there? The bulgogi. There's so many good foods at Trader Joe's, though. We didn't want to make everything Trader Joe's here because, you know, not everyone has one. But, man, if you live near Trader Joe's and you're craving Asian food, I don't think you can go wrong.
But I think in general they do regional food. I know we're talking about Asian food, but if you try the chili tamale,
yeah,
that's good. The Cajun, yeah, Alfredo sauce, oh, that's awesome. You can mix it with your beef tendons ball.
Yeah. The South Asian food, yeah, they do a really good job. I mean, it was a little cringy when they call it Trader Jose.
Mm. Oh yeah, Trader Ming's.
A little cringy. But the food was good. I couldn't argue with the food, and it wasn't trying to be mean or anything. They're just trying to be clever and cheeky. But yeah, so whoever's doing the ethnic foods over at Trader Joe's, give that person a raise because they're doing something good over there. And then I see here you also recommend Malona bars, or how do you say it?
Yeah, Malona bars. They have a lot of different flavors, like they have banana, they have coconut, I think mango. But my favorite has to be the melon. The melon one is the best one.
Classic. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Cool. So yeah, if you want to end your meal with something sweet, we have some options for you there as well. A lot of Asian desserts are cold because in Asia it's so warm. And I remember, you know, when you're in Hong Kong or you're in, you know, Vietnam or Thailand, you're not craving, you know, a warm apple pie or something like that. You want something cool that, you know, you want a shave ice, or you want an ice cream or a popsicle or a cold Sai Milo or something. So yeah, Asia is not known for the desserts, but there's some newer stuff coming out, which you can find in your frozen food aisle. Give it a try. All right, guys. Well, thanks for coming along on this journey. It's fun having you. And yeah, I didn't say this at the beginning, but thanks for listening. I know Angus is one of our most faithful listeners. I can see our analytics, and we can see what state people are in. So we always get a couple downloads from Texas, and I think of Angus whenever I see a download from Texas. So thanks for listening. You guys have a episode that you like out of the ones that we've done?
I really like the travel one because that just really connects with me. I mean, Curtis and I talked before the pandemic. I was on the plane about once a month, if sometimes more often. Now, whether it's domestically or internationally, you know, I would make a trip to Singapore for the past 5 years, almost every year, same with Australia, just doing all those things. And yeah, so when the travel tips about, you know, just dropping a bag of chocolates and stuff, I mean, that's what we do. And you get your meal served first. They ask you for your meal first and your choice. And I never have to struggle with a second choice.
Yeah, I also enjoyed that travel one too, because it just kind of made me reminisce on like some of the trips that I've been to and how I'm itching to like travel again after like the pandemic is all over. Like, I want to go to, like, so many places, but I also want to, like, revisit some of the cities that I have gone to before.
Yeah, and like you heard, you know, once you're in Hong Kong, like, if you have a place to stay in Hong Kong, you can jump on a plane in 2 hours, you can be in Bangkok or Tokyo. That's amazing. So that'd be and, you know, in education, we have those long summers.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, one of my favorite episodes, definitely has to be the one with Mandy and Kelly on the YouTube food, the YouTubers. And I love that episode because I knew exactly who you guys were talking about. So it was really awesome to kind of hear that, oh my God, we watch the same people. So I really enjoyed that episode because I also love BuzzFeed and all the people from Tasty and especially all of the Asian food channels.
Plus, and you work with Manny and Kelly.
That's
fun too. That's fun. Mm-hmm, yeah. Mm-hmm. So, hey, thanks for listening. Everyone out there, thanks for listening too. And hey, if you want to be on the podcast, send me a message. You never know. I have a topic that, you know, fits with our program here. We're open to ideas. I've had some non-Asian people, Alicia that works with Melody in the office down there is like, can I come on the podcast? I'm not Asian. Sure. Right. Because I think that the idea of the podcast is just to talk about Asian things that we love, and you don't have to be Asian to love Asian things, right? So, thank you three for listening, and everyone out there, thank you for listening. We've had a good couple months here. We started in June, so we are building our listenership a little bit. The Shang-Chi episodes were pretty popular, so I think this one will be popular too when people want to find a good frozen food to listen to us try some frozen foods. Coming up, we have a couple episodes that might be interesting to people. We're going to do another K-drama episode.
Ooh.
But this time we're doing a collaboration with my friends over at K-drama My Eyes Out, their podcast. And so they're coming on, and what we're doing is, do you guys know anything about fantasy football?
Mm-hmm.
You've heard of it, right? Mm-hmm. And so the way it works is you pick teams from the available players. And so instead of doing a fantasy football draft, we're going to do a Korean drama draft.
Ooh.
Where we're going to each take turns, and we're going to pick our favorite dramas in order. But the thing is, once someone picks a drama, you can't pick that drama. So you have to be kind of clever as you're picking your drama. So that's going to be fun. We're going to have 5 people on that one. We're going to have Jennifer and Nadira back, and also our friends Judy and Linda from K-Drama My Eyes Out podcast. So we're doing that one. We have our Asian sitcom show coming up, and we're going to do The Eternals, the Marvel movie called The Eternals, which is not, you know, centered necessarily around an Asian character, though there are several Asian characters in that movie, but it's also directed by Chloe Zhao, who just won the Academy Award for Nomadland. So she directed that movie. So I think it's going to be a great movie, and it's coming out in November. So I think we're going to rent out a movie theater again. So I don't know about you, Angus, but if you're in town, but Emily and Melody, if you want to come along and watch The Eternals with us, you're welcome to come along. My treat. You can come along and just say you know me, and we'll let you in.
Thank you.
But yeah, look forward to those episodes. They're coming soon. Lots of new ideas coming down the pipeline, so keep listening and check in every Tuesday evening if you're on the West Coast, or Wednesday morning. It'll definitely be there, new episodes every week. So please check where you get your podcast or subscribe, and maybe they'll notify you. But until then, thank you to all my guest hosts. Thank you for coming along. And until then, on behalf of Melody, Emily, Angus, and myself, we hope you're all happy, healthy, and safe out there. Thank you all for listening, and talk to you soon. Bye.
Bye.
I'm taking a chance because I like you a lot, so I'll give it a shot. Give it all that I got.
Asian frozen foods.
It was so fun, you guys. Curtis, I just think you should do another food episode, and we have to be on again.
Yeah.
That was amazing. Yeah.
It's fun, right? Yeah, we got to do... Well, how could we do another one? We could do... We chains? Can... Like, we could do Panda Express. I mean...
Panda Express. No, Panda Express.
Well, okay, there is one. I don't know. Maybe you guys can come along on this one. If you want to do this one with us, Mandy and Kelly and I are going to do a ramen challenge where we look up recipes online at YouTube or whatever, and we try different celebrity ramen recipes
Ooh.
Or instant ramen hacks.
Instant ramen.
So, you know, there's like the mayonnaise and egg mm-hmm. one that people do. There's like ways to dress up instant ramen. You know, there's different hacks that people do.
Yeah.
So we were thinking about doing that one in December.
Okay. That's fun.
So I don't know. I was thinking about trying to do it in my backyard, but I don't know if the weather will be good. But that would be fun, right, if we're actually in the same room together.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I know it had to be my garage or somewhere with adequate ventilation.
Another episode idea is Studio Ghibli's. You know, all those Castle in the Sky, Totoro.
Yeah.
I mean, there was some Western exposure to that now. And
yeah. Is there a big... I'm waiting. Like, it's the 20-year anniversary for Spirited Away.
Mm-hmm.
But I was thinking about trying to coincide that with something big, something happening with Studio Ghibli. But I'm not an expert. I never am. But you know, like, I know there are some hardcore fans out there, so I need to find someone like super hardcore. That would be one, or anime.
Yeah, and anime.
But I'm not huge. My daughter's into anime. Maybe I'll have her.
Oh yeah.
But I know a lot of kids are in anime, I can find.
Mm-hmm. I'm not. Kid.
Yeah.
Mine's are like 20, 30 years old. So.
Yeah. It's a
Captain Tsubasa, Doraemon.
I've never gotten into it. I've never really gotten into it. Or manga. I mean, not really any of that. So, yeah, we have some ideas. I think we are going to do a Hong Kong one. I think we're going to do... I have a photographer friend, and she's really into Hong Kong cinema. So I think we're going to do one on Tony Leung. Because, you know, he really killed it in Shang-Chi. So I think we're going to do one on him. Mm-hmm. And then my sister's doing a takeover. She's going to take over the podcast for a week. And she has some chef friends in L.A.
Ooh.
So, Shirley Chung is one of her best friends. And she was on Top Chef, and she has a restaurant down there.
I would love to be introduced to your sister.
I know.
I'm probably not the only one that said it. But yeah.
She's got a lot of connections, yeah. All right. Well, thanks, guys. Thanks for giving up some time for me.
It was so fun.
Yeah, thanks for that was fun.
Yeah. Anytime there's food involved, Curtis, just call me.
All right, guys. Thanks so much. See you soon. Bye.